Yeah, hello everyone. I am Tejas Sakharkar, manager of the Energy Club, and I welcome you to this podcast session. So today I would like to introduce you to our esteemed speaker, Mrs. Vidya Amarnath. She is currently the CEO of Paterson Energy, a company which is converting plastic into a fuel. So yeah, let's talk about it with ma'am. So ma'am, the first question is like, a former employee at the bank and now a founder and CEO of this renewable energy, like plastic to fuel company, Paterson Energy. So like what happened in between? Like how did your career path change so drastically?
So just to give you some kind of familiarity with me and a commonality between all of us, I'm a Mumbaiite. Okay, so I'm from Bombay, born and brought up in Bombay. And soon after my wedding, which was very young at the age of 21, I shifted to Madras, which was Madras at that time, now Chennai. So I started my, I'm a cost accountant. I did my commerce graduation from R.A. Poddar College, and then I'm a cost accountant. So I got into the banking industry, where I started my journey with Bank of America. And Bank of America was then taken over by ABN AMRO. And soon after that, I started my family. So I was expecting my first child, my son. So I realized that the banking hours was not conducive for me to be working that long, because it was almost an 8 o'clock to 8 o'clock in the night shift. So I quit my journey with the banking. And but since I'm always used to doing something, it was difficult for me to, you know, not be a full-time mother and not do something, you know, to in my career path. So I started then becoming a newscaster. So I'm a newscaster with a local channel, which all of you know is Sun TV. So Sun TV had an English news channel at that time. So I started, you know, reading the news. So that was a time when I could juggle both my, you know, take care of my family and my very young son. And I had a daughter soon after. So it was, you know, I needed something that had a balance between my work life, this thing. So that's the reason that I started doing something that kept me occupied for some time. And then, you know, at the same time, I had enough time for my family too. So slowly, when I started this thing, you know, looking around the environment, I realized that a lot of plastic waste was causing a lot of environmental damage. So my husband and I, he himself is a financial and a wealth management expert. He runs a 100-year-old company in Chennai, which is called Paterson, and they were into the wealth management and stockbroking side. But then we started this initiative basically because we were concerned about the environment. So everybody was talking about plastic recycling, saying that plastic gets recycled, but still it was all around the place. So you could see your bins filled with single-use plastic, cattle, you know, consuming that, and which was a sorry sight for marine ecosystem. So we wanted to understand, you know, what exactly was recycling of plastic and how much of plastic is actually getting recycled. And so in terms of the process, I will explain shortly what happens in the plant. So when you put in plastic waste, so the waste plastic is basically washed and segregated. Now there are only certain types of plastic that we put into the reactor. So this is PP, PE, LDP, HDP. We don't accept PET. Okay, why we don't accept PET is because there's already a very well established chain of recycling for PET. You'll never find a PET bottle on the road because our rag pickers, who are the heroes of our segregation, they just pick up every good material and then, you know, it's recycled. So we don't accept PET, and we don't accept PVC, nylon, those materials, because, you know, the chloride element, the chlorine element, you know, tends to corrode the reactor. So the longevity of the reactor is the same. It becomes less. So we don't accept PVC material. So now getting back to the process, the questions now.
Yeah, okay. Nice to know that. Actually, the thing is, I am currently third year energy science student, and we have exact like this things that you told. I was relating them. Like we just now, just in the past few weeks, we studied about the different types of reactors, then the feeding back the gases and increasing the efficiency, like fuel decreasing the fuel. So that's all.
As I'm talking, it'll be very nice weather, you know. See, our company has established an MOU with a lot of educational institutions, like we have done with Technische Universität, which is Berlin University of Technology. We have worked with VIT, is Vellore Institute of Technology, is with us. Then SNU, Shivnadar University. So I would also like in the future to find out, you know, whether we could have some such agreement with IIT Bombay, where I could, you know, send in our experiences on the ground, practical experiences, and you could help us with solutions on, you know, by running tests at your end. So what will happen is, not only will you have, a more engaging academic course at your end, but you would also be interacting with people in the industry who actually give you on the ground the same problems that we may face, right? So that is something that I would really like to have with you, since you said that, you know, you already are in this field. Now, one of the major things that I find is that, you know, when students like you run tests and, you know, they have their own prototype of a reactor and run these tests, what they essentially don't understand is that, firstly, the real world circumstances are completely different. What you do in the lab is under controlled environments, and you're dealing with, you know, pure materials. So if you put pellets of HDP or PP, and then you tell me that, you know, I'm able to convert it into 80% fuel, it's obviously going to happen because you're putting pure material. But in the real world, rarely do you find, material which is pure, because plastic material comes with fillers. So you don't know what is the percentage. Although they may say that this is PP, you don't know whether actually, you know, the percentage of PP that is there in it and what is the amount of fillers. So in the end, the yield will definitely not be what you do in a controlled and sterile environment, like what you do in
Okay, so one more question is job versus entrepreneurship. Like, you have done both, you have worked as a job in a job and as a founder of this company. So how are the experiences different? And just tell us about that.
So the first thing is that you're your own boss. I mean, that's one thing, but that's where it ends, right? I mean, if you feel that, you know, that is an advantage, so that's where it actually ends, because in terms of comparison for this thing in a job, you have limited hours of work, you have assured salary, you have limited worries, your responsibilities are limited, but here your responsibilities are never ending. You have invested your own money, so you know that much more pressure on you to make it work. Then you also are answerable to so many other people, like, you know, any government person can call me up at any time in the night and, you know, say that I want this immediately. So you need to be a 24/7 person rather than a 9-to-5 person. That's the first that's the first requirement. So you have to be driven. But having said that, you know, it's like owning the company. Like, when you giving the share analogy, you may buy some shares in Infosys, but that doesn't make you Narayan Murthy of that company, right? So there's a huge difference. While you can reap in the benefits of what the company is doing, Infosys is doing, through your shares or through the dividends that you get from the share, but you won't get that kind of appeal to be an owner of the company. And especially because, you know, when you have a vision for your company, you're able to run the company. That's that vision is definitely, you know, when you are the founders of a company, you can have a vision for your company and as well as, you know, a purpose for this company. So that may not be possible if you are in a 9-to-5 job. You are told what you're, you know, you have certain duties that you have to perform and very little leeway to actually, overexpress yourself or, you know, achieve what you want to do through your purpose. So that's one thing. But of course, everything has its pros and cons. So if you're, you know, there is a lot of risk. So you need to analyze what is that risk analysis in your life and also what is your ability to take that risk in reality and then assess whether, you know, you want to be part of a company. Not everybody needs to be a startup entrepreneur also. Some people can also, you know, be a part of another company's vision. For example, if I...
And then one question is like... anything that you would like to tell the young young students, or as you are a woman entrepreneur, so anything that the advice that you want to give to college girls or college students in general regarding starting new venture or the thing that you did family as well as the this thing. So
yeah, as a woman, it's definitely that much more difficult. I mean, it's not that I'm playing the femininity, the feminism card or anything of that sort, but it's definitely a more difficult task because women are expected to do the balancing act, or maybe because, you know, they are believed to be the best micro managers, right? You know. I shouldn't say micromanagers, I should say they're the best multitaskers. I'm sorry, I should not say micromanaging is not the right word for a woman. They are multitaskers. They do it very well. So maybe that is the reason also, you know, we are all the time forced to play that balancing act between family and, the career. But I think it's fast changing because women are also, you know, at least in the urban scenario, we find that a lot of women are coming into their own and, you know, laying a stress that it is not necessary that you need to know everything. Okay, you can always take help along the way from every aspect, whether it is at a domestic level. You don't need to know how to cook or how to do everything. Nowadays, you know, there are options for everything, and it's primary importance, like even Modi ji said this in his interview, you know, don't ask girls what they are doing or why they are late or be overly concerned about them. But then if you instill that behavior in boys that, you know, that you are responsible as a human being to also take part equally in the domestic affairs as well as a professional affairs, it's really... not necessary that you have to be a superwoman. Every woman is a superwoman by herself. But, you know, there's no need to raise an eyebrow when a woman says, I don't know how to cook, or I don't know this, or I run a technology company in which I may say I don't know everything. I may know the basis of the process and everything. But if you ask me what is the formula of that methane that comes out and how that is going to be this thing, you know, how, what is the exact reaction? I seriously don't know. And there is no harm in saying I don't know. Because, you know, you have a team of people who are going to help you in that way. Like in every field, if you see in the cricket match, that IPL that's happening, CSK is performing very badly because the teamwork is not there. You are expecting one man to do everything, and you know that's not possible. So everybody brings something to the table, whether it's your family member or whether it's a team member who works in your company. And there is no harm in saying that I don't know something and be willing to learn, right? I think the effort should be there. The yearning to learn more is something that all of us should possess, especially, you know, I think, I shouldn't say especially women. Women always have the strive to do that. But, you know, for women entrepreneurs, yeah, so as I was saying, whatever you do in life, somebody is going to be upset and somebody is going to be unhappy. So, you know, within that purview, I mean, where you keep your values and you don't do something, you know, against the basic value systems, you have to know that it's okay to say a no. This is what, you know, women find difficult these days. The thing to say no. Expectations will never end from people, but then you shouldn't overstretch yourself. When you know you can't do something or it's beyond your capabilities, ask for help. And secondly, it's okay to say no. It's fine. Right. You know, because when you see women like your mothers or, you know, the women of the previous generation, because they've been putting so much of stress on themselves, they've not been telling people the, you know, how, what their mental issues are or what their day-to-day life problems are. They have so many physical problems also that have come about because of their inability to express themselves. So I think one thing that every woman has to learn is to express themselves and learn that it's okay to take help and it's okay to say no. It's fine. Everybody is learning, and not everybody in the world, there's not a single person in this world, I believe, who knows everything.
Okay, yeah. So one last question, just informal question, like apart from the company and apart from like family, the work, anything else that you do, anything like hobbies or...
So I do read a lot. I mean, my iPad has all kinds of books of various, you know, subjects and various genres. So my favorite author is this Turkish lady. I forget. I never get her name on first. She is one of the Booker Prize winners also. Okay, I'll get back to that. So I do a lot of reading, and I'm a fitness freak, so I exercise a lot. So I do a lot of weight training. I'm into yoga, and so nutrition and fitness is one of my main thing. I don't know whether it's a hobby, it's a lifestyle change. So the author's name is Elif Shafak. Okay, so in many ways she writes about a lot about women, and she's a Turkish author who writes about, you know, about all her protagonists are women. And so I like her books a lot. So I read a lot on those subjects. So I like Mughal history a lot. So so currently I'm reading this series by Alex Rutherford, which is a series about the Mughal dynasty, starting from Babur, you know, to Bahadur Shah Zafar. So I like Mughal dynasty. So I like to read about you know, the Mughal era a lot. And and I read a lot on, because I do a lot of talks. I mean, this year I have not done a lot of, seminars. I've not done a lot of talks this because of the pandemic, but I used to travel a lot and I used to address a lot of, forums from CII to student communities. So I read motivational books. I read on technology. So I like to do these kind of, I listen to a lot of TED Talks. Because I myself have done a TED Talk, so I listen to a lot of TED Talks. Yeah, so that's, so that's my.
Is the company, like, is the work still going on? Like, is it begun?
So we have commissioned the plant, and we have done a few tests, and we are working with Indian Oil Corporation in Mathura, who is, you know, helping us do the testing of the oil and make us help us understand the specs of the oil and all that. So, but we have not yet started, production in full force. So, which we will be doing slowly, because, you know, as I told you, because it's so dynamic, plastic. So we have materials coming in various forms and various compositions. So we need to do a lot of R&D on it to understand where, you know, what kind of yield we get and how the plastic composition actually, you know, affects the composition of the oil. So we need to do a lot of tests, but I think soon we will be utilizing the capacity full strength.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am, for joining.
Okay, all right. Yeah, sure.